President Trump this morning denying that he gave any moral equivalency to white supremacists in Charlottesville, with those protesting them and all they stand for. Except here's a problem with that argument, Mr. President. Those were your own words. It comes as the president steps up attacks on senators from his own party. Joining us now, Michael Eric Dyson, professor and author of Tears We Cannot Stop, A Sermon to White America, and also Brunell Donald-Kyei, the former vice chair of diversity outreach for the National Diversity Coalition for Trump. It is very nice to have you both here on a very important morning once again. Professor, let me begin with you, because this morning the president remains unapologetic. The word is, from our reporting, no resignations are expected from those close to him at the White House. You have Republicans in Congress largely in hiding, at least when it comes to actually calling out this president by name. So is this president, and a lot of, by the way, pretty high approval still among Republicans, over 80%. Is he getting a pass?
Oh, I think so. I mean, the reality is that people are complicit with this president, who has refused to acknowledge that he has done an extraordinarily awful thing here. So in typical fashion, he is defensive. He is attacking his own people, his own party, perhaps even his own staff members, as opposed to acknowledging, like any mature adult would do, I made a mistake. Let me then clarify what I did.
Except that is how he ran and he won.
Well, absolutely right. But it doesn't make it right. It makes it effective. But now the efficacy of it is being challenged because he is now amplifying some of the most heinous bigotry that we've seen manifest in this country in a long while and at the top of the food chain.
Speaking of amplifying, guys, in the control room, can we pull up the cover of The Economist? Because I want you both to be able to see. And Brunell, let me know if you can't see this. But this is the new cover of The Economist, which is hardly, you know, a leftist rag. I mean, this is a center-right publication with the president holding a bullhorn that is a hood, a KKK hood. And Brunell, Chris just did this fascinating interview with Ellie, the reporter from Vice, who was embedded, you know, with the white supremacists down in Charlottesville. And here's what she said about how those white supremacists are reacting to how the president has responded to all of this. Listen.
They love him. They love him. I mean, this is one of the only groups in America where Trump is routinely exceeding expectations. When he said that, when he essentially defended him, one texted me saying, God bless this man. He truly does have our backs.
Now, you've said on this program this week, you hate everything that they stand for. But how do you square the two when these guys are saying, we love what the president is saying about us?
Well, I'll square it like this. You know, these people are a minuscule, small, petty part of our population. They do not reflect the entirety of our nation. And I'll say that our president is, there are a lot of people who are happy with what our president is doing as far as our economy, immigration, jobs.
Not what I'm talking about, though. Come on, let's stick on this issue that is about the morality of this country.
Sure.
All right, about that issue, your response is?
Well, I'll tell you this, that what's going on in the country, there's been a morality problem in the country for a long time. This didn't just come with the President Donald J. Trump. And these people who are now being magnified in the media as if they are a core support of Donald Trump, it's not true. Donald Trump was put in office by people across the spectrum, different religions, people who were sick and tired of the politicians living off the backs of the people, not keeping their promises.
Take your point that this has been a consistent problem in America. That's not the question. The question is the president unifying the country amid that? Is he said one word that did not further divide the country after Charlottesville?
Yes, I believe that he has said plenty of words that of no division. And basically what he said is, what matters is the red, white, and blue. What matters is that
That's not what he said. Professor,
he said that in his speeches.
Facts matter. His words matter so much.
They do.
And his words, Professor, were both sides, on many sides.
Yes.
Both sides were to blame.
Well, of course. And this equivalency between white supremacists, bigots, neo-Nazis, and people who are protesting it is what the man said himself. So despite what Sister Brunell is trying to argue here, the president's own words condemn him. He has an inability to acknowledge his faults. Then he goes forward to deny what he did. And then when people like Ms. Brunell speak about it, they're complicit in the very mendacity, the very lying, the very inability to tell the truth that America is made on. And the man's words himself condemn him. And you're trying to talk about red, white, and blue when he was talking about white versus black. And he was talking about white supremacy and bigotry. He was talking about white supremacy and bigotry, reinforcing the kind of hate that we see in this nation.
For now.
We are tired of the division. This nation wants to heal. All the races want to heal. The majority of us who love this country and the freedom that it stands for, we are tired of the bickering back and forth. The president said that there was problems on all sides. Imagine your fellow journalists had urine and feces thrown on top of them, and nobody's condemned that. No one said that, and that wasn't the white supremacists. That was Antifa.
For now, the white
throwing,
hold on.
You know,
all right,
this
for
urine
now,
and
for now,
feces
for
on
now,
people.
No one is defending.
So come on, let's
no one is defending throwing
let's
urine, etc. But there is a strong difference between people fighting for equality and people fighting for wiping out people off of this earth
they
and out of this country.
Down there, though.
That is,
you know
and,
that.
Brunell,
and the routine,
one,
both sides.
Brunell,
both sides.
Who killed Heather Heyer? Who killed Heather Heyer?
Yes, somebody died, and I understand
no.
that. And of
who
course, our condolences
Heather
to the
Heyer,
family.
A white supremacist
I believe that
and
there
sympathizer
was, yes.
murdered
I'm not saying that
Heather
that was
Heyer.
Right.
I wish.
Where
I
is the equivalency
right.
in that?
I didn't say it was right.
Where is
but
the equivalency,
you
though?
Is,
you're saying they
both
had weapons.
They were armed. They you're were armed. They didn't come to just protest. They came armed as well to counter-protest.
If this,
so
if,
that's what I'm
if,
saying.
If Brunell, wait, hold on. You've been talking, Brunell. If Brunell could be just as outraged at the kind of white supremacy bigotry that's manifest here as her own intemperate remarks in
outraged.
Regard to trying to exaggerate what happened down
I'm
there with
tempered.
A few... What about the routine excretion of feces rhetorically in tweets every morning about 5:30 in the morning. This president is incapable of restraint, of deferred gratification. We're talking about actual bombardment of rhetorical nastiness unleashed upon the American people. That's what this president does every day. The inability to acknowledge what he is doing, the inability to tell the truth about what's happening here, and your stunning inability to tell the truth fundamentally, you look like you're complicit in the very lying that's going on in this
state. Our children need jobs.
People
they don't need you to race bait, sir.
The
they
left
need
wing
you to
did not kill
them.
Anybody.
Guys, I want
the
everyone
right
to hear
did.
Your arguments.
Approach the
I
president.
One at a time.
Help the nation. You're not helping. You're race baiting.
How can
you help
on.
Our young people?
Hold
they're
Brunell.
Dying out there.
Brunell.
They're dying.
Brunell.
They need jobs.
Brunell.
Self-hatred. They need
Brunell.
Jobs.
Brunell. How is the president helping in this right now? How is he helping in this right now?
What I'll tell you, he's got a million new jobs in the economy. He's busy working these NAFTA deals that our poor and middle class can have jobs.
As long as he brings jobs, he can be a bigot.
That's
as long
important.
As he brings jobs, he can be a racist.
He's not a bigot.
As long as he
he's
brings jobs, he can make
when
an equivalency between morally reprehensible
people,
facts.
Jackson,
guys,
Al Sharpton,
she's
all
been
of
talking.
These people,
women, women. She's been talking. I've been kind.
If
she's
he
been
would let me finish, I'd like to complete my statement. When Donald Trump, before he ran for office, he was giving money to all these politicians, blacks, whites, all of them. He wasn't a racist then. He didn't become a racist until they knew that he was going to win that election when the American
not
people
at all.
Stood
can
up
I respond?
Tall and said,
may I respond?
Sick
let's
of the
let
politicians.
The professor respond.
Ask Al Sharpton.
No.
Ask Reverend Jackson.
Hold
all
on.
Of these people will
Brunell?
Tell you he gave them money when nobody would give them
Brunell,
money.
Brunell, your voices
stop
are both
with the race baiting.
Your voices are very important for everyone to hear, so I want them to hear them. Professor, your response.
He was a race baiter. He was a race baiter when he was going after Barack Obama as an illegitimate citizen of the United States of America. He was a race baiter when he led the birther movement. He was a race baiter when he talked about Mexicans as rapists.
Clinton.
He was a race baiter when he talked about Muslims
facts.
And Islamic people as being demonized. He was a race baiter from the very beginning. So the amplification of his bigotry is no surprise, but nonetheless disparaging and dispiriting. And if Brunell
and
would wake up and smell the coffee that has no cream,
too.
She would see the unvarnished hatred
okay.
that has been revealed.
Brunell, you just questioned a fact.
I hear the hatred in your voice.
Brunell, hold on.
Not
let me
at
get,
all.
Let
passion,
me get my
baby.
Question. Let me
passion.
Get let me get my question in
intelligence
there.
Intelligence with
passion.
Let me get
and
my
it's fire. Dividing the nation.
Let me get
dropping bombs on you.
Guys, hatred is
we have
dividing
plenty of
the
time,
nation, sir.
But I'm not going to continue this if you don't let me ask a question. Okay. Brunell, you just questioned a fact
yes,
that the
ma'am.
Professor made,
sure.
which is that President Trump, as civilian Trump, before he was a candidate, time and time again, with no basis in fact, questioned where President Obama was born and what religion he ascribed to. That is on President Trump and President Trump alone. You said Hillary Clinton.
What
back that up.
Yes. Yes, of course, we know the news came out that Hillary Clinton's camp started that birther.
There was one email question circulated years ago.
I can play for you back to back
the times the president went on the national media before he was running, and he said over and over again, something's up with that birth certificate. Where was he born? What religion is he? That's on President Trump, is it not?
Absolutely. The bigotocracy is deeply entrenched in America. And you can be a black person reinforcing bigotry.
Sides, sir.
The lesson we learned today, white supremacy has no preference for skin.
If I may respond, please. The bigotry and the hatred and the hypocrisy is on both sides. That's with the GOP as well as with the Democratic Party. It's so much anger and hatred and jealousy because this president actually stood up for the nation and won against elites who are used to living off the backs of the people. The hatred and the vitriol is this way because the Democratic Party didn't win. And so what I'm going to say is this. We have got to take our nation back. We've got to get rid of this hate and
are you
anger and unforgiveness and move
forward. Let me just ask Brunell a quick question. You just said, Brunell, respectfully, the hatred and the vitriol is this way because of the Democrats. Are you saying that the KKK and the neo-Nazis and the white supremacists went and carried out this horror that is a national tragedy in Charlottesville?
Or voted for Hillary
because of Democrats?
What I'm going to tell you is that the hatred and the vitriol of the white supremacists, that's been decades and decades. And it didn't just come about because Donald J. Trump became president.
That's not what we're saying.
They were marching and doing all of these things as well. They were doing this under the former president. I am asking you about the way he responded.
When you come out and you say that it is both sides, just like the president did.
Yes.
That is putting them on the same ground. That is saying that people that want individuals like you and the professor off this planet are on the same ground as those who are fighting against everything that stands for. Help our viewers understand that.
Okay. She can't. She
Let
has
me
no
help
words.
You understand
it's
that.
Thin.
Excuse me, sir. I've been
You've
talking
been talking all
elders,
along. I haven't even been able to get a word in edgewise. All I'm saying to you, you are the manifestation of the lethal intensity of the internalization of self-hatred,
you are
spoken loudly and amplified without regret.
You are a race baiter, sir, and our young people
need
jobs.
That's a hackneyed phrase. What is a race baiter?
They need you to go to the table, talk to the president, and help them get jobs.
Ma'am, all I'm telling you, I'm teaching, writing, preaching. I got a lot of jobs.
They're in the more.
Brunell,
we're
professor,
talking about today.
Brunell, professor, you
our
will
young
both,
people need help.
You will both be
no
back.
Your manifest with lethal
you will, both, for help. You will both be back together. We're going to leave it there. Thank you very much.
Bless you.